Hi there folks, today's demonstration is for all those people that are fed up of processing their invoices and receipts manually. So the new GPT-4o model came out this week, it's now available on Azure, and so I've put together a demonstration that will not only show you how potentially you could use this model to automate your invoice and receipt processing and extract the common entities like the value and category of that receipt, but also how you can deploy that model into Azure and further develop that automation in Power Automate so that when someone simply uploads a file into a SharePoint document library, all of that lovely metadata is extracted automatically and then updated on that file within SharePoint. So I'm going to kick things off with a demonstration from within Power Automate. I have a pre-built flow here, and that starts with a trigger. The trigger has an input parameter and accepts some file content, and that will be my invoice or receipt that I'm going to pass into the GPT model. Then I have a compose action, and in that I have my prompt, and I'll talk about how I devised this prompt later on in the video. Next up, I have a compose with my key in it, and I'm keeping that secret, but the best practices there would be to use something like the Azure Key Vault. Then we move on to the HTTP action. I'm calling the endpoint for my deployment of the GPT-4o model that I have on Azure, and that's of course part of the Microsoft technology stack. It's not leaving Microsoft, it is on Azure. It is not going to the OpenAI third-party service that is available also as an API. Then within this, I'm passing in my API key, but I'm also passing in a body, and that body contains all the parameters that are required to call that API, and some key ones that I'm going to call out. This response format enables me to specify that any response back from this model is in a strict JSON format. There is no other supplementary text that will come back from this model, and that allows me to then work with that structured data and use that further on in my flow. You'll also notice I have roles, so I've got a system role and I've got a user role. Within the system role, I have the output of the system prompt, and within the user role, I'm using that file content that's passed in the trigger so that we can pass that into the model and review the image and extract all the data that's based on the prompt, all of that lovely invoice and receipt data. Then I have a couple of more compose actions, one just to demonstrate the full output that comes across. It's just an expression. It's the first from the choices array of that body that comes back from the HTTP action. And we're looking specifically at the message content. And you'll note that I've also got that wrapped in the JSON expression. It's coming back as JSON, but stringified. So by wrapping it in the JSON expression, it validates it as JSON and I can use it in subsequent expressions. Now I could use parse JSON at this point, but I've jumped straight into another compose and just written a few different expressions. So based on the amount, you can see the expression there. It's the output of the full output. And I have a question mark and in square brackets, single quotes, the word amount. I then have again in square brackets and single quotes, transaction underscore date, transaction underscore time, and of course category. Now this is all based on the prompt that I've defined. I specify with a sample object and therefore the model will follow that and give me the data back in the same structure that I have requested. Now if I bring across a receipt that I have from a recent trip away, you can see it is a taxi receipt for 20 euros on the 14th of May 24. It's also on its side, but this is taken with my mobile phone camera when I was out and about. If I jump back into Power Automate, where I have the flow set up to run a test, it'll ask me to attach a file. I'll go and pick that same receipt and attach it, and then I can run the flow. With the flow now complete, we can see that the HTTP action has run. My inputs are hidden because, of course, my key is set up as a secure input. But if I scroll further down and we can have a look at the body, we can see some of the data that's coming back into that, including all of this structured JSON. But as we move a bit further down again, the thing that I want to highlight here is the number of tokens that have been used in order to complete this request. So there are a split on the completion tokens and the prompt tokens, and then based on the model, we pay a slightly different rate. But when I work this out, it's costing approximately 0.1 cents. That's right, so not 1 cent, but 0.1 cents to run this prompt. If I jump down onto my compose full output, we can see some of the data that's been extracted. It's a receipt type of type taxi. We've got the transaction date is the 24th of May 24. The amount is 20, currency is euros, category is transport. And then we can see some of the other data that's been captured, of which there's none for the payment method because it was just a handwritten receipt for cash. We have the vendor information. So it's pretty impressive what that prompt has returned as a result of supplying the image as part of that API call. And then if I look at the summary, we can see that I've simply brought across the amount, the transaction date, and the category into a summary. And of course, you could write that to some metadata of the file or to a third-party system. And later on in this video, I'll actually show you how we can update this flow so that it will use the when an item is created trigger, and we will therefore process a file as it's uploaded, extract the data, and save it to metadata on that file in SharePoint. So if we move across now onto Azure, I'll quickly have a look at how this was all deployed. You can see I have several Azure OpenAI services deployed already, including ones in different regions. And it's important to note the different regions because depending on where you deploy, you get access to different models. And by models, I mean GPT 3.5, 4, and then the recent one, 4.0 for Optima. So in order to use Optima, you need to have a deployment here in East US. And I have my DB ChatGPT POC instance here. And if I click on that, we can then go into my model deployments. And whilst there'll be nothing here, I can manage those deployments now over on the Azure AI Studio. So over on the Studio in Azure, I can see a model catalog, and I have previously covered a video on how to deploy, for instance, the Mistral model and build out a Canvas app with this model. But what I want to look at really is the deployments, and right now I can see that I have, in fact, tried the different deployments of GPT-3.5 Turbo and Turbo Instruct, but also today I have deployed GPT-4o. So if you want to deploy, you can use this Create Deployment Wizard, fill out a few buttons, and you will have your own instance of the GPT-4o model ready for you to use. If I click on that, I can see a bit more detail about this model, but if you open in the playground, it's here that you can start experimenting with the model. And if I want to just introduce myself and say, hi, my name is DemoBird365, we can see we get a nice greeting back and ready to run. Now, if I was to go and use this attachment feature, I could upload my receipt that I had earlier and ask it to extract details about this invoice. And we can see that image uploaded, and then soon afterwards we start getting some data back, and it's extracted some data basically as some bulleted properties. Now, because I've not been very specific about the data I'm looking to get back and the structure, it's providing it to me in plain text. And of course, in an automation, that's not much use because I want the data to be structured, hence why in my prompt I've specified I want it to be in JSON. But before I explain how I built that, another look at some of the other settings available. If we have a look at this show JSON, you can see the key value pairs for the role of the system, the user, and the assistant, albeit there may be a little bit of a bug here because the content for the user isn't coming through. But this is ultimately what's happening when you have a conversation with a GPT model. We're building up objects of key values for the role and the content. And the really exciting thing about GPT-4o is that the content can now also include images, and soon it can also include audio as well, all in a single API call. Now, if you're wondering where I got the API endpoint for this, you can go to view code, you can see your endpoint, but there's still a little piece you need to put in after this in order to make sure that you hit your endpoint. You can also see your API key, which is also available from Azure OpenAI. You can copy it there from your keys. So some sample code here for Python, for JSON. Again, you can see that body that's constructed with those pairs. You can also see some of those parameters that I also had in my prompt earlier. The little tip from my end is I use developer options. I couldn't clearly see where the endpoint was. And so by typing a message in here, for instance, hi, if we look over on the right-hand side, we can see the URL that's been hit. In this case, the GPT-4o Omni, OpenAI.azure.com, and all of the various endpoint data after that as well, including the deployment, the name, and the fact that it's chat completion, as well as the API version for the 1st of April 2024. Now, I also noticed during testing, and this may well be a bug whilst it's deployed, the preview feature kept giving me an error when I tried to pass in images, so I did use a different version, and you can see that in my flow from earlier on. So hopefully you've now got everything you need to deploy the model in Azure. If we go and have a look at ChatGPT, as in the ChatGPT, you can see how I devised my prompt. So jumping across over onto chatgpt.com, it's here that I initially uploaded a taxi receipt and I asked it to act as a document model and extract common entities. And it's here that I started to devise my idea and also the prompt. And we can see that it gave me some JSON data. I then uploaded another example of a receipt and again asked it to do the same. And it gave me some JSON as an output. But I quickly realized that the format of both of them was different. This one here shows taxi receipt as one of the keys, and this one here shows payment receipt, which of course for an automation is no use because of course the structure is changing. So that then led me on to suggest or request that we get a standard format. And from that, I had these example keys, the different data types, and in comments, some of the examples. And I further developed this to suit my scenario. After a long conversation with GPT, I then asked it to write me a prompt so that GPT-4o could behave as a document extraction tool as described above. And we can see that I ended up then with quite a nice looking prompt, and it seemed to cover all boundaries and also included that sample JSON that I discussed with it also. I did still make a few modifications off the back of this, but you can see how I use GPT not only to test the concept of extracting data from an image and structuring it as JSON, but I then use GPT through the prompt to devise my own prompt that I can use with my API. And that's what's giving me this consistent data output as a result of using the API with a prompt. So back over onto my flow, rather than using this manual trigger where I would upload a file, I'm going to delete this and replace it with a trigger for SharePoint. So we'll have a look for file created, and we have when a file is created properties only. So I'll select that and attach it to my SharePoint site. I'm not seeing it there, so I'm going to enter custom data and paste in the URL. Hopefully that'll enable me to select my SharePoint document library, which is documents. And then with that, I need to get the file content. So I need another action, get file content. And if we select this one here, just get file content. Again, if I paste in the URL, I should be able to use the dynamic value for the file identifier. And we can see by doing a search, I can select identifier from the dynamic properties. So that allows me now to get the file content into this existing flow. And if I go into the HTTP action and scroll down where I previously had the file content from the manual trigger, if I remove that, I can then replace it with the updated value from my get file content action. So we can see I have the file content dynamic value here. And as a final action, what I'd like to add in now is just an update file. And if we have a look here, we've got update file properties. Again, using that same site, I'll go into custom because it's not seeming to finding my new site. We'll choose the library once more. We can choose the dynamic value for the ID of the item that was created. And if I have a look at the full properties, we have a placeholder or metadata for amount, for category, and for date. So if I look at the summary, the amount, the expression here is the compose full amount and then question mark amount. One way to copy this is to go to code view. I can just grab the expression here for amount, control C, jump back onto the file properties, into my amount, into FX, and paste that in. I now have the amount. For category, no surprises, it is just based on changing this amount to category and adding that in. And then in terms of the date, just as a reminder, if I jump up to my system prompt, why am I using all these names? Well, these are the things that I've defined. I have here transaction underscore date, but I also have currency and amount. This is what's coming back through in my structured data. In order for me to get that transaction date, of course, if I go back into the file properties, into date, into FX, I can paste that in and I need to type in transaction underscore date. And so by adding that, if I save and test the flow now, when those files are uploaded into my SharePoint site shortly, it will trigger this flow. It will then extract the data using the GPT-4o model, and then it will update the file so that the metadata is saved back to that file in SharePoint. So jumping across onto the SharePoint site into the document library, if I bring across three different receipts or invoices into the document library, they will then upload. I've got a receipt for Wagamama, so we can maybe have a look at them while the flow is running. I have copied this from the internet, someone's receipt from 2017, all the items that they've ordered here, and I'll also highlight in the output the fact that all of these items are actually tabulated. They come across in a JSON array. So if you did want to use this individual line items in another system, this data is also coming back through in this automation, just that I'm not using it currently. The other two receipts, I've got that familiar taxi receipt and also a receipt that I had for a train. So over on the details pane of Power Automate, we can see we now have three instances of that flow running. If I do a refresh, they've all failed. If we go and have a look at the history, we can see that the error message we're getting back is actually that we've got an invalid image. So the base 64 data is incorrect. So how do we solve this? If we have a look at the get file content, I've passed in the dynamic value for file content, and that actually includes the content type and the content. And I just want this content because I just want this base 64 string. So rather than passing in the dynamic value for file content, I actually want to change that expression so it includes this dollar content as part of the expression. So if we go back into edit, jump into the HTTP action, and if I scroll down to the file content, we can see that at the moment it is just returning get file content. I want that dollar content. So if I remove that, go back into the FX, into dynamic content, choose file content, and append to the end of this expression in square brackets and single quotes, dollar content. If I add and save that, I can jump back over onto SharePoint, delete these files from earlier, drag those three files back up again and upload them to trigger the flow. And then as if by magic, we can now see we have the amounts, the category and the date all completed for these three uploaded files using Power Automate and GPT-4o. Jumping over onto Power Automate, I have captured the run of the Wagamama version. The reason being, I wanted to have a look at the full output. We can see the date from 2017 and the time, etc. But the thing I really wanted to demonstrate was the items. So we can see here, we've got the Coke, the tap water, the gyoza, the EB katsu, chili beef, etc., yakisoba. If I bring up that receipt on screen as a reminder, we can see how the model has extracted the amounts and these products into an array called items. And of course, that is incredibly useful for any of your further integrations that you might want to do. Validate that individual items are appropriate, are not above a certain value, below a certain value, etc. And so that ends the demonstration. Hopefully you've learned how to deploy GPT-4o. You've got plenty of use cases now flying about in your mind. Make sure you leave some comments and let me know what you're thinking. And as always, if you haven't already, please make sure you like and subscribe. Hopefully see you again sometime soon. Thanks so much for watching. Cheers. Bye.